faced with two wrongs. Now we're faced with two wrongs. I don't know. Oh, I don't know. Now we're faced with two wrongs. Now we're faced with two wrongs. I don't know. The song is Four Walls by Bastille, which was actually written about In Cold Blood. The full name is Four Walls, the Ballad of Perry Smith. The Ballad of Perry Smith. 7 minutes late. Yeah, my car got towed today, so I'm running behind. Sorry. Yeah, it just kind of proves that you can't really plan for things, so... Anyway, we're not going to think about that because it kind of gets my blood boiling. We're here to talk about In Cold Blood, which the second part was pretty intense, I have to say. It's just crazy. I want to jump right into it, but I also want to... Oh, Maddie, I'm really sorry to hear that. I don't know what that would be called. Sorry, it's a little messy over there. Been running around. So today we were going to talk about the backstory and things we learned about In Cold Blood, when it was written, how it was written, where it was written, why it was written, all of those fun questions. And then we're going to jump into talking about part two. I had asked earlier if we wanted to have some people request to join the live so that we can talk. I see Lexi jumped on, so let's do that. Oh, a few quick statements I want to say about joining the live. If you join the live, I would like that we try not to repeat any information. We'll say hi, but no, we don't really need to say, what's up, how are you? We can just cut straight to it because we only have an hour and I want to really stay true to that time. And I want to get as much conversation as we can. So try not to repeat information. You can say hi quickly, but no, you know I'm talkative, so we'll just start talking and that can't happen. And then also, if any of the material you feel is going to be possibly dangerous to hear or triggering in any way, just give everyone a heads up. Be like, guys, this is going to be kind of weird. Or, you know what, I'll just do it generally right now. The information we're about to speak about. Okay. We're about to speak about can be triggering because it is about a real murder that happened. Some highlights that I will speak about very quickly. In Cold Blood is a novel written by Truman Capote about a real set of four murders that took place in Holcomb, Kansas in 1959, November to be exact. The Clutter family, four of the members, four of the six, were murdered in cold blood by Perry Smith, and Richard Hickworth. Yes. So those are the basics. Let's see. Yes. If you don't feel confident speaking whatever language, yo.
Hey.
Hey. So thank you for joining the live. If you want to just introduce yourself to all of our readers, that'd be awesome.
Hey, it's Lexi. How are you doing, y'all?
Cool. And Lexi, what did you find out for us?
Okay, so this is a weird one because you just said that In Cold Blood is written by Truman Capote, but the story was written by somebody else before him. Okay, so we've got Richard Hickok, who obviously is one of the perpetrators, and he wrote it with a journalist called Matt Nations. He was a pretty big journalist in Kansas at the time. I literally have pages of notes, no joke.
Great, thank you.
Okay, so in the manuscript that he wrote over 200 pages and sent them to the journalist called Matt Nations, claiming that there was a reason why they did it and it wasn't the reason that Capote came up with. Hickok stated that they were paid $5,000 by someone named Roberts to murder one or more of the Clutter family.
Wow.
It gets worse. The story was buried. Yeah. The story was buried by KBI and the Kansas State Attorney General. They allowed Capote into the prison to visit the prisoners on death row, even though there was a ban on the media entering the prison for death row at that point. He was allowed to circumvent that for some reason. Funny that. But Matt Nations wasn't. Matt Nations ended up being charged with tax evasion that he was later acquitted of. But in the process, they took the manuscript from him and buried it.
Yo. Mm-hmm. See, I didn't find that. That's pretty awesome. Wait, so how much validity do you think this version of the story has?
Well, there were a lot of researchers, especially the guy who wrote the Truman Capote and the Legacy of In Cold Blood. He's called Ralph Voss. He's researched Capote for donkey's years, and he'd never heard of the manuscript. He'd never heard of the journalist himself. Hi, Stella. And he thought it was really odd, but the manuscript exists. Like, there's someone actually has the physical copies of it, and it's 100% legit. Like, it exists. It's been written down. It was written by one of the perpetrators, and I just find it very suspicious that Mac was asked to send the manuscript. He sent it in February 1962. And a month later, he was arrested on tax evasion charges. That just seems a little bit too convenient for me.
It's very fishy. That is definitely sketchy.
Yeah. There was another part to it as well. Where is it? Right. So we've got seriously 3 pages of notes. No joke. There we go. So in the movie Capote, they portrayed him as like visiting death row all the time. Like he was constantly there.
Yeah.
Absolute lie. He didn't visit for almost 2 years. Until he heard about the manuscripts.
And then he had to kind of go verify his facts, I bet.
It was more he wanted to go and put a stop to it. And then when Matt Nation shot his manuscript to, where was it now? Random House, it's called. He didn't know that they already had Capote under contract for the story. And then obviously it got out, this manuscript existed, and quick as a flash, Capote went and visited after nearly 2 years of not going anywhere near them.
Oh, wow. Okay, really quickly, I see a lot of people asking, KBI is the Kansas Bureau of Investigation. Every state has its own state-run Bureau of Investigation, part of the FBI, but not specific to the crimes that happen within that state.
Yeah, so it's like a level down from the FBI, yeah. So exactly. Like the FBI, like their supervisors.
Exactly. Like, if you guys watched, if anyone watched Outsider, the TV show with Jason Bateman, they worked with the GBI, the Georgia Bureau of Investigation. So yeah. They have it for every state. Sorry, you can continue.
Matt Nations never got it published. The lawsuit completely ruined him, right, with his job. He got fired. He was financially ruined because of the law, like the legal charges and stuff. He did manage to publish an excerpt of the manuscript itself in a magazine called Mail, but it's defunct. Nobody can find it. But Mac Nation's son thinks that the story was completely shoved under the
Ridiculous.
table so that Capote could capitalize on it, which is kind of sad. So,
But there's
yeah.
something about, in my research, something of everyone that kind of came in contact with this in like a special way seemed to
Yeah.
have kind of been cursed.
Yeah.
Like the two people that committed the murder, both, as we know through our research, were eventually set to death by hanging in Kansas at the time. We know that Capote's career never really grew from there, although he grew in fame and whatnot. He never finished a whole book again.
Yeah.
And he, because of, you know, I think he thought very much of himself. So when he didn't get awards for this book and whatnot, he started to drink and go into and kind of spiral and was never back up to the level of artist that I think he kind of found in this book that kind of created a whole genre.
Well, considering the hard work he put in, because he literally hired one of the biggest law firms in Kansas to fight the ban on media attending death row, and he won. So he put a lot of work into making sure his manuscript got out there. So, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, oh man, it's I thank you so much. This is like such cool information. I didn't know this. That's awesome.
I went on a Baileysarian and just kind of deep dove into everything. And yeah, I nearly didn't get back out. But yeah.
Yeah, well, we're glad you
Thank
did.
you.
Yeah,
But
Capote did
yeah,
have a very distinct
the
voice.
son of Mac Nations, he's actually done a few YouTube videos and stuff. So I'll send them to, I'll either tweet them to you or
Yeah, I
whatever.
would put them on the Twitter, yeah, and then I'll
They're
retweet
really
them.
interesting. So yeah.
Super cool. So, yeah, I think that's everything
Yeah.
here. So I'll sign you off and see if anyone else would like to jump on.
No
Lexi,
worries,
thank you
bye
so
bud.
much. Awesome to see you. Say hi to
And
everyone
you,
for me.
bye.
Okay, bye. Wow. See, this is like the really cool thing about doing research like this, especially when it's about a book that was written 50 years ago, over 50 years ago, 60 years ago now. Yeah, I'm terrible at math. But yeah, I think that's fascinating. And that's, you know, one of the things about the times back then is they could really get rid of things. Now we have social media and then other things that, yeah, Stella wants to be a part today. Mind blowing. Would anyone else like to jump on and share other information that they found? I know that seemed kind of like, I don't know how heck we could top that, but yeah, fascinating, fascinating. I mean, I'll keep sharing things that I found. Well, I don't know if anyone else, that's why you, maybe that's why. I found myself wanting to look at art. Capote actually descended into severe depression and alcoholism because he apparently lost himself in the tragedy and died in 1984. And the circumstances around his death were, let's say, for lack of a better term, mysterious. To this day, it's being argued whether or not it was an accidental overdose or a suicide. So people to this day don't know, although he did jokingly on a talk show before say, like, oh, I'll probably kill myself before then. And he made some reference to suicide. If that's triggering for someone, I apologize. But yeah, so if you send me a DM on Instagram, I'll be able to look at it, but I won't be able to answer. I feel like we're investigating together about the book and the story. Exactly, that was kind of the goal. This was one of the first novels that blended this factual account, this nonfiction story written by a novelist. And that's why I think it got so much critical acclaim because it wasn't in the usual style that he writes. Yes, he did write Breakfast at Tiffany's, which was then later made into the screenplay. And in my research, I found out that he wasn't too happy with Audrey Hepburn. He wishes Marilyn Monroe would have played the role. Mark Barclay, I'm gonna have you jump in. Oh, Odin's Raven is coming in. Odin's Raven. See if it works. You guys know Instagram is not my friend.
Hey.
Hey!
So
Your cat
he,
made my cat jump away.
yeah,
Yeah.
Toothless wanted to be a part of the live.
Really quickly, can you
So,
just introduce yourself for everyone?
hi, I'm Odin's Raven, or Sarah. I'm the one who's talked about being in law enforcement and this being similar to stuff I've seen.
Cool.
So, Truman Capote wasn't originally specifically writing this book. He saw a 300-word
like excerpt in a newspaper, and then had 8,000 pages of notes that he had looked through, because he wanted to write crime, but he wanted it to be like specifically literary. But this case swept the nation so severely that it caught his attention. And then he ended up writing the book with the same author that wrote To Kill a Mockingbird. Because they were childhood friends.
Him and Harper Lee, that's right.
So he, you had mentioned that he didn't get any awards for it, and he almost felt betrayed because he thought originally that as soon as To Kill a Mockingbird came out, that that's where all of the attention went. And then his book kind of just died.
Was that the... I read that him and Harper Lee kind of had a falling out. Was that why?
Wow! Because he thought that he had taken all the attention away from his book. And it just essentially got buried in everything that Harper Lee had done.
Wow.
So that's when the drinking started and everything else. Because he just thought, well, you know, I put so much work into this. And this book almost killed me, so... To get no attention, what's the point, you know, at this stage?
Yeah. I mean, I can only imagine when, like, when we read that he wrote this book. I mean, the crime happened in 1959. The book didn't publish and come out until 1965.
Yeah.
I think 1965. So he wrote this book for 7 years, or 6 years.
That's yeah, so he much took time. 6 years to write this book.
Yeah, can you imagine putting that much time into something and then it actually blowing up to everyone loving it and then just kind of being like, oh, okay.
Right. I mean, it really was like a one-hit wonder of books.
I can't believe, I mean, I can believe it, but it's, that's why I'm still going to persist with my idea that I think it was all cursed, like to
oh,
this
yeah.
whole event. Yeah.
Cool. There's no doubt about it in my mind. I almost think that, you know, as soon as he wrote the book and people sort of realized, hey, this got swept under the rug more than it probably should have. I think that's when people started to really notice that the book was written and that it's something that happened and it's something to not be ignored.
Yeah. So just a question to ask you that I would ask anyone. So do you see why the book has kind of persisted as this like fascinating book though?
This book actually, so I read it as part of one of my law classes in college.
Oh, cool.
And it fascinated me. I read the book in probably 2 days because I just couldn't put the book down. And now reading it again, I'm able to see things from the outside.
Yeah.
Like I said, I don't get to see that very often. So to see it from how you guys would normally see it instead of from the law enforcement side, it's different to read it from those two different perspectives.
Do you find that us reading it from the perspective of trying to understand and then like very much like Capote trying to humanize these murders. Is that what's the difference in perspective that the law enforcement perspective brings?
So the law enforcement perspective really is me trying to figure out what makes them tick. Like what made Perry do what he did? What pushed him, if there even was something, or if he just snapped, you know, to kind of profile why he did what he did. What led up to it, and then to see it from the outside, it's like, okay, how can I almost humanize the pain that he probably was going through at that point without seeing it from solely a work perspective?
Yeah, that's really cool. Yeah, well, thank you so much for joining. Like I said, your perspective is always more than appreciated, especially in this book. So if anything else comes up and you want to share, by all means, just let me know.
Perfect, thank you.
Cool. Yeah, no worries, so I'll have you hop off. I did this right. Yes, okay. We are not talking about curses anymore. We are not cursed. We are not cursed. I think something about this, the essence of the story. Really quickly, I found myself trying to look at art from the time period, specifically art 1959. And one of the art movements that was kind of coming post-World War II, the post-war art period, was like abstract expressionism. Right? So this idea that people were trying to paint things that represented different emotional states. If anyone knows more than this, more than me, which is probably a lot of people, but please let me know. But I remember specifically, it brought me back to this one time I was in the AGO in Toronto, which is this museum. And please stop. I don't like curses. at the AGO in Toronto, and it had this whole period of art where it showed the paintings specifically. I was in Toronto at the time, so I was in Canada. Specifically, the paintings pre-World War II and post-World War II. In pre-World War II, we saw a lot of very like pastoral paintings of landscapes, beautiful, with maybe a small cabin to kind of exemplify the simplicity and beauty of lifestyle on those big open plains or just lots of landscape. And then post-World War II, it was cool because the museum was set up like this. So as you were walking and the years were going back, and the years were continuing to pass, you literally see a shift post-World War II, where you stop seeing pastoral and then, you know, very, I don't know how else to put it. You know, just like simple paintings of time and place, and you start seeing these paintings that are just abstract and trying to express emotional states. And I think it's really cool to think that. And then when I was thinking of that, I was like, it's almost as if this book did that for the nation. The nation was post-World War II, living in, especially in the United States, it was a time of a lot of growth. That's when America, I guess you could say, the militarization of America started to grow. American imperialism started to really boom. The economy started going up in the United States. The average family, you see the nuclear family, all of these things, these idea of it being this shining city on a hill, so to speak. And then this terrible tragedy that forces the nation to confront the fact that still exists. And I thought it was crazy, crazy. Art was emotional, thus the abstract. Thank you, Mila. We're reading something once about murderers who work as a duo and how there's often one person who's more dominant than the other less, which I think now doing research and whatnot, even learning more about their personalities makes 100% sense. We could definitely see that Richard was the force. He was, I always confuse which one's which, but Richard, I believe it's Richard that was the one that I watched an episode of on the History Channel. They had a whole In Cold Blood thing, and they said, you know, he was the one that pulled the trigger. He was the one that wanted to sexually assault Nancy, and Perry was the one that said, no, I'm not standing for that, which does speak to a level of empathy and understanding that Perry had that I don't think Dick did. Like, I don't think he did at all. Exactly, post-war. Dick was younger than Perry. Yes, we're talking post the Second World War. But I would advise all of you, whenever we are brought a script that is from a different time period, and a specific time, that's one of the things we like to do, is look into the music and art and prevailing kind of pop culture of the time and see how that reflects society, kind of like Hamlet says, art is to hold a mirror up to nature. So like it's interesting to kind of go back and kind of dig into those levels. So I suggest everyone do that. That's always really cool and interesting. And anything else that anyone wants to bring up? I think we covered a lot of research. As we continue with our reading, if everyone continues researching and learning new things, please continue to share with me, and I'll continue to put on Twitter. I can't swipe up on this Instagram for some reason, and I don't want to put it on my regular Instagram, so I'll keep tweeting it out to everyone. Yes, Katrin, how messed up was that with the dogs thing? It just proves that he had this break of empathy. Yeah, like we're kind of talking about. But also, wasn't Dick the one that didn't want to pass? I believe that Capote had a relationship with Perry that was different than Dick, and he actually even left before Dick was hung. It's a weird sentence. Before, you know, Richard was put to death, he said, "I can't stand to see anymore." So he left, and I think that also has to do with the connection between them. Seeing Perry passed that way was was too much. And in a way, Perry had a different understanding. He accepted his death, whereas Richard, they had to carry him up to the gallows because he wouldn't go up, which is also a thing that I learned, which I thought was crazy. And now reading it in the research, I remember that scene in the movie Capote. Another quick acting thing. Philip Seymour Hoffman talks about the specific Capote voice and how it was extremely difficult to do and hurt him. So he had to treat it as though it was an impediment. An impediment in acting is something that you do that's like outside of you. Like they could say like, or a different state as well. Like being drunk can be seen as an impediment because you have to live a truthful reality, but now with this other layer put on top. And he saw that accent as that. So in doing that, you have to rehearse a lot. So it becomes, the accent itself becomes second nature. Maybe later we all can do our own Capote impressions. Honestly, what got me was Dick's ability to convince two new women that he would marry them. Like he was so convincing with no real money or power to convince random women to care for him. Scary. Well, correct me if I'm wrong, but isn't that not common behavior, but emotional tools like that are often used by people that would be considered sociopathic because they recognize the ability to manipulate with that. I think it also speaks to like, I don't know. Capote's voice was weird. I thought it was interesting how Dick didn't commit a crime until he hit his head. I found that you can develop psychopathic tendencies due to a head injury. Interesting. I was a bit stunned when I first heard Capote's voice. Yeah, Dick was said to be handsome and charming. That makes sense. I mean, how many other murderers have we read about that are said to be handsome and charming? Right now, what's his name comes to mind? Zac Efron played him in the movie. You'll know. I can't remember his name right now. Absolutely sociopathic. Okay. Manipulative and sociopathic. Okay, cool. Awesome. Yeah. Yeah, cat hair, right? If Capote did the audiobook, would have killed the whole thing. I mean, narcissistic tendencies. Dahmer, yes, but there's another one. Bundy, Ted Bundy. There we go. Thank you, Lana. Dick emotionally manipulated Perry as well. I feel that Dick was attracted to, if not in love with, Perry was attracted to, if not in love with Dick. And even in that, we hear Perry talking about his experiences in prison and how he alludes to possibly some sort of like same-sex relationships that weren't, he wasn't opposed to, and then there were times that he was. Correct me if I'm wrong, did anyone else kind of see those allusions or those possible things? It's unrealistic, but some people say that Nancy still haunts the house at night by wandering through the hallways, but there's no real evidence through EVPs or REM pods. I think when something like that happens to a soul, yeah, I would 100% believe that house is haunted, without a doubt, not a question in my mind. I believe in stuff like that. I believe souls are precious and sacred, but I believe that events like that can cause them to split and leave pieces of themselves here instead of moving forward. We don't talk about my spiritual beliefs, but I 100% believe that house is haunted. There's a line about how when Perry told a lie, he would stick with it. Kind of seems like he made so much stuff up, he went along with it so people wouldn't know he lied. Well, is a lie if you believe it's true? Yes, but no. If I don't think I'm lying, to me it's not a lie. So if you can convince yourself of anything, I don't know. That's the human mind scares the crap out of me because it's one of the most powerful things in the universe. It can at once make you feel like you're king of the world and dirt not even good enough to be on your shoe. Crazy thing. And it can convince people of anything. Such a powerful tool. I think it's sad that the Clutters are remembered for the gruesome way they died and not the accomplishments of their lives. They were robbed of that. And I think that was one of the tragedies. The episode of on the History Channel that I watched, if I find it, it's in three parts, about 12 minutes each part, 12 to 17 minutes. They talked to the prosecutor, and the matter-of-fact non-sympathetic way he feels about how those men were murdered by the state. Kind of blew me away too. I mean, he's like, I feel no sympathy. I don't think about it. It doesn't matter to me if they were shot, took 2 minutes to die, or took 20 minutes to die. Dying is dying. And I feel no remorse whatsoever. Also kind of scary. I don't know. There's something about that. Oh, no, that's not what I want to do. Thank God's not sleeping tonight. There was definitely some indications of homosexual relationship with Perry during prison. Okay, cool. I'm glad I wasn't the only one that was like, wait, whoa. What I found interesting is that this part is called Persons Unknown, but you get to know at least Perry a lot more during this book. So who don't we know? Right? I think that's cool. Yeah, I believe it leaves like an echo when somebody's trapped. Yeah, like a rift. Okay, I see other people requesting to join. So it's going to be Mukunda Gandhi. Pardon me if I said that incorrectly. Declined. Okay. I think Dick Perry had possible feelings for him, which is why he called him honey and baby to manipulate him. Absolutely. Absolutely. Yes. Terms of endearment like that. And then, yeah. I think we all, there's just a simple, another little tangent. You guys know I like to do this. Words have tremendous power for violence, for compassion, for empathy, and for manipulation. And in endearing terms like that, I agree, we have power. He was living his truth. You see that all the time with people. People living their lives to their own truths, irrespective of others. Psychopaths are often very smart. That's true. Did anyone read up on the Walker family murders? Jordana, will you please enlighten us? Jesus, don't make the whole thing death sentence thing very unsettling. Sorry. Does make the whole death sentence thing very unsettling. Yes. I mean, Perry... Pardon me again, triggering information. Perry was hung for 22 minutes before they pronounced him dead. 22 minutes. That's like a full episode of The Office. And I know that's kind of a weird way to think of that, but literally you could start the episode, watch the whole episode, and he was hanging there the entire time. There's a quote somewhere about understanding why a murderer did what they did. It doesn't have to make sense to you. It only has to make sense to them. I mean, that's, I guess, what free will is, right? Perry's sister's letter in response to his letter. And then the analysis, right? The analysis was fascinating. And I think it was pretty on point. Rereading it and then reading the analysis, you're like, he made a very succinct and completely understanding analysis of this person's letter, whether or not even she intended. I want to know more about this person that Perry was so enamored with. I thought Perry's recurring dream of trying to get a diamond and then being eaten by a snake was interesting. Amir trying to get Clutter Fortune and ending his death. Well, Triforce of Dragons, what's up? Yeah, I thought that was... Well, remember, in the first part of the book, they talk about Perry's kind of subconscious inklings, his almost... what do they call it? His... psychic abilities, his ability to kind of gather energy. We have different ways to kind of talk about it now, and some people don't believe that's a thing, and other people do. I believe some people are closer to that, and I wouldn't doubt if Perry was really having the dreams he had like that. He had the potential to be someone cool. Mar Barclay, this is you. Dick, we don't know much about that. No, we didn't learn about him that much. Not yet, anyway. Okay, declined. Beverly, the older sister, actually said, it's their life I want to immortalize, not the way they died. That's the one reason why the sisters don't like the book. In the few people that were interviewed in the History Channel episode, I'm going to share it with you. It was on YouTube. In the few people that they did interview, you know, you had kind of the town was split. Some people were like, oh, it's all fooey. We know that no better than some sort of gossip magazine. And others were like, I read the book and I thought it was done very well. And I think that speaks to the ways that people dealt with this horrific tragedy. And to me, that's what I think the most disturbing part of it was. I guess our society is now more kind of like the people in the town said, we're more used to seeing and hearing about these horrific things. Back then, it was just something that didn't happen. And I think that was the worst, was that rupture of innocence, that destruction of it. That is one of the things that really gets me about when someone does something that is bad. I can say that murder is absolutely bad, always. I believe that. And that innocence lost, that will never come back to not only that family, to that town, to that state, to the nation. It rocked the understanding of who we were as neighbors. Kind of scary. You know, Perry from the perspective of his father and sister, but who is Perry really, right? I think Dick and Perry had some heavy mental influence over each other, believing their own lies, maybe saying, that's cool. Alberto, I went down a different dark hole. And Lexi, basically a month after the Clutters, the Walker family was murdered in Florida a very similar way. Jordana, would you want to hop on for a couple minutes and just kind of go down that tangent for a hot sec? We also do have to talk about part two. So, but I guess we kind of are, right? I think we're kind of flowing in and out. And I like Persons Unknown, we go into other people. We go into Dewey, the investigator from the local town that was trying to figure it out. We go into some extra family members or people that commented on the murder. Wow. The rain doesn't bother you if you're wearing a raincoat. There's a quote. We kill people. We kill people to help people, to teach them that killing people is okay. Yeah. We kill people to show people that killing people is okay, not okay. Yeah, I agree. I don't agree with the capital punishment. Willie's a very smart person, and I wish he actually stayed with Perry and possibly helped him. It was like Willie was his guardian angel, and Perry was the devil on his shoulder, and Dick was like the devil on his shoulder. And really quick, this does just touch on like the influences around you. Pay attention to the people around you. My grandfather used to say that, like, if you want to know who you are, look at the people you surround yourself with. I'm paraphrasing. Jordana, I'm going to bring you on. Is that cool? Boom. Yo.
Hey, hi.
Hi, if you want to introduce yourself really quickly.
Hi, I'm Jordana, for everyone who doesn't know that already.
Just said hi. So what did you find out about this Walker family murders?
I was kind of just reading up on it, and I think it's like about a month or so after the Clutters, there's this family in Florida that was murdered in kind of a similar way, like the entire family just in the night, they were all just shot in the head. It was the wife, the husband, and their two kids, which is honestly, it gives me the creeps just thinking about it.
So it was the same.
Pretty similar. And they happened to see Perry and Dick around the area at the same time because they were traveling away from the Clutters at that moment. So there was a lot of speculation about whether they were involved in that as well.
Yeah.
They made them do a polygraph and they said, we didn't do that one. But people were still not too sure about it. And till date, it's kind of an unsolved one.
Okay. For everyone that's not going to sleep tonight, I apologize.
I'm not sleeping because it's like 2 in the morning here and I'm freaking myself out. So.
Oh, my goodness. All right. Well, thank you for sharing. Thank you for joining. I'm going to sign you off. Make sure I don't hang up on everyone. We're good. Wow. See, that makes you think of all the like, speculation. What if, now I go back to what Lexi said in the beginning, what if they were paid to do it? And then because they were paid to do that, they're like, oh, we'll go do this crime too, and no one will know. Who knows? This book I knew had a lot coming, and that's why I wanted to make sure we did our due diligence here. Exactly, I'm thinking copycat killer. Hello, it's Mary here. I'm gonna, it seems that you're hopping on. Is that cool? You're coming through. Hello.
Hi.
Hey. So if you'll introduce yourself and then share what you got.
Wait a minute. My mom was watching Aladdin, so I can't.
properly hear you.
All good.
Sorry. Okay, I'm Arianna.
Hi,
I'm from Italy.
Hello.
Ciao.
Oh no.
Let's skip this. Oh wait, no. Hey.
There we go. Yeah.
Sorry, internet woke up.
All good.
Yeah, I actually skipped this book because I'm focusing on J.J. Abrams' book. I don't know if you knew it.
No.
Wait, show you. Sorry. Yeah, this one. I don't know if you know it.
No, I don't. I don't know that. What is it?
Cecius something. I don't know if it's... Actually, it's in Italian, so I don't know the...
It's okay. We'll find it later. What were you going to share about what you found out? Or?
I found this on the net, actually. I don't know. I was just searching for a book, and I just fell in love with the plot. It talks about... a girl to find a book in a library, and then she writes note in this book, so as you can see it.
Mm-hmm.
And she starts talking with another guy, and they try to solve a mystery and try to know is the real life of the 8-year-old book. It's quite interesting.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, well... Well, thank you for joining.
Bye.
Bye. Yeah, Lexi, I'm not even gonna take that in. I don't want to know these things. I would never sleep again. I'd move, frankly. I don't know if anyone's ever done research into like serial killers and how many they believe are operating at once and ones that don't get caught. It's a whole. It's not a good thing for sleeping. The name of the book in English is Ship of Theseus. Or Theseus? Theseus? For those watching In Cold Blood, please watch the 1967 version. Powerful, raw, and really made me think. And then I tried to watch the 1996 remake and lasted 2 minutes. The 1967 one, Truman Capote had a part in. Which I think is really fascinating. And I think when we do our watch series, where we're gonna watch probably a couple movies about this book, because I think it's just so cool. We'll watch one of the modern ones, and then we're definitely gonna watch the one that he had a hand in. In an interview that I shared, he talks about how he felt it was almost impossible to make a film from a book. And there was always gonna be nuance that you were gonna miss. I would agree with that. I think the power of the image does a lot, but it's the attention to nuance that you subconsciously take it in an image. In a book, you read every word. So, but I think it's interesting because that's the one that he directly had a piece in. And we're gonna watch Capote as well, the one that Philip Seymour Hoffman won the Academy Award for, which actually another movie came out that same year about everything with Daniel Craig and Sigourney Weaver and a couple other people. When you're touched by tragedy, it definitely changes you. One of my close friends is very good friends with Leslie Mahaffey, and he remembers searching for her when she was missing. Oh, I'm so sorry. Yeah. Yeah, thank you to everyone that joined in today. We have about, we already only have like 10 minutes left. That was a very fast live. Does anyone want to talk about part two specifically? Anything you want to bring up? I'm going to talk about one thing really quickly here. Page 88, which is page 88 for me. Where she said, as usual, Mrs. Claire's notions conformed with those of very few. Round here, according to the proprietor of one of Garden City hardware store, locks and bolts are the fastest going item. Folks ain't particular what brand they buy. They just want to know they hold. Imagination, of course, can open any door. Turn the key and let terror walk right in. Tuesday at dawn, a carload of pheasant hunters from okay, blah, blah, blah. And then the other section is, however, one woman, a school teacher, observed, feeling wouldn't run half so high if this had happened to anyone except the Clutters. Anyone less admired, prosperous, secure. But that family represented everything people hereabouts really value and respect. And that such a thing could happen to them? Well, it's like being told there is no God. It makes life seem pointless. I thought that was just a very powerful passage, because that, I think, really surmises like what people were feeling. It already feels like this book is going to keep us busy longer than we normally use for books, probably. The reality of this book is terrifying. It makes me shudder. And you know, if this was just a person with a sheet over them, they'd have to worry about me. Time flies. I have a quote. Please, share your quotes. I have a theory Mrs. Clutter met Dick's friend at a medical center she went to. The town lost its innocence. I read that to my mom and she told me not to read anymore because she got scared. Yeah. Same exact breaks I have then. Awesome. Yes, Maria, I agree. Seeing how it affected the town and how people chose to leave as they no longer felt safe. That's another thing. I felt so bad when I saw, I remember the husband's name, Hide, but I don't remember their last name. The Japanese family that chose to leave, and they were valued members of that community as well. This is exactly what my friend Olive referenced when she said they pretended it didn't happen. They don't want to take away from their memories, good people. It's all the same in eternity. As far as responsibility goes, no one really wants it, but all of us are responsible to the community we live in and its laws. Wish they told Republicans that. Sorry. There was a quote there, Umberto, imagination, of course, can open any door. Turn the key and let terror walk right in. Right? Can I do Capote's voice? If I hear it,
he kind of talked in a very strange way. And it's very strange. I don't know. I'd have to listen to it a lot. As long as you live, there's always something waiting. And even if it's bad and you know it's bad, what can you do? You can't stop living. I really like that Capote tells both the victims and the murderer's sides of the story, but only uses Dick and Perry's first names to give them different treatment. Interesting. I'm going to start paying attention to that. Thank you, Katrin. I found the section about the orphanage and the parrot very interesting. I have a quote, but it's too long to post. Amy Lumsden, if you can share the page of that quote, I'll try to find it. We opened some doors today and let the terror right in. That's right, we did. I locked my door last night, that's for sure. I found it interesting that they were only looking for local suspects rather than a wider area. From the letter of Perry's sister, I is not the same to have a dirty face. Yes, there is no shame in having a dirty face. The shame comes when you keep it dirty. And I think that speaks to a lot of actions when people make mistakes. Mistakes are going to happen. It's how they live after. It's that keeping their face dirty. That quote transcends just what she was speaking to, but also what she was, it was pretty cool. I was thinking it's a bit like the universe rule. You move from order to disorder. This sort of feels like the equivalent, a town's descent into order and chaos. Disorder and chaos. Wow. Emily Hopes Butnick. Yes, love that. Imagination, of course, can open any door. That's right. Hey, Pops, what's up? It is no shame to have a dirty face. The shame comes when you keep it dirty. Yes, you are above the intelligent man, but somehow your reasoning is off the beam. Let me actually go to sleep now. All the keys behind this book make everything more interesting, creepy, but I'm totally in. It's 101 in my book. Let me look and see if it's the same for me. What is the, it starts with the parrot appeared. I don't think we're going to be close. We don't have the same book, I'm sorry. I think we're off by a few pages, I can't find it. If anyone has the same copy as me and knows where that quote is, if you can share, that would be great. Yes, the Ishida family. Yes, oh, I felt so bad for them. Um,
You never would have read this book without Rosende Reads, and now I want to have a career in forensic psychology. Fascinating. Time warning. Oh, my goodness. Now we are definitely under 10 minutes. We're about 6-7 minutes left. How much are we reading? Thank you for keeping me on track, everybody. Let's see, we're on page 160. So if we go to 260. We're going to finish the book for next week. We're going to finish the book for next week. Shame is a big motivator for people. Shame makes us do strange and impulsive things. I felt that quote was quite telling as it taps into the idea of shame and passing the shame. I think there's also an idea of shame that once you wade into the pool, you might as well start swimming, you know? And there's something about, like, once they started the crime, they had to finish it. They couldn't not finish it. And I feel like if they could have, Perry would have stopped. But he didn't. Okay, we need more time. Then no worries. Let's cut it in half. The last thing I want is everyone rushing through and skimming pages. Okay, part three. We're going to read part three. All right? I know some people, if you would wish to continue and finish the book, by all means, that is okay. But we will do part three, which is going to be a shorter portion. Got my mind thinking now. No, part three. Part three. We will do part three. Sorry, Annie. You can continue reading if you'd like, but we have to think of everyone. And I agree, the last thing I want is people skimming or saying, I'll just wait till we talk about it. No. We're going to read part three. So there we go for everyone. So there's plenty of time. Stop it. We're not talking about curses. Okay. Just part three. I know that's a little bit shorter, but I think that will be fine because in part four, and then when we do part four, we'll add a movie in. How's that? So part three, so that when we do the last bit, which would be part four, and it's shorter, and we can add, we're going to talk about part four, and we're going to talk about a movie. I will decide which movie next time. I'm going to say most likely, so if anyone wants to start that movie or do it anyway, the 1967 version. We're going to start the closest to not only the source material, the author, but also the time period in which it happened. And then we'll go to the one that's a little bit more removed. If that's the plan. The curse will be lifted once we finish this book. There is no curse. We are not cursed. Stop it. We're not speaking this curse into existence. I'm saying I think there was something people around the event, the people that tried to profit from it, the two killers and the author. That's a curse. Schedule for the night. Sounds like a plan. Is there a sage burning in the background there? I hope if something's burning back there, it shouldn't be. How was it possible that such effort, such plain virtue, could overnight be reduced to this smoke, thinning as it rose and was received by a big, annihilating sky? I love that. There are a few movies, but there's the original In Cold Blood film. I will share which one it is on my on the Instagram. I'll post a picture of the poster with the director's name and whatnot so that we all can find it and what lead actors there are. But that's the one that Capote had his hand in, so I'd want us to read that after we read the book before we decide to go into ones that have a little bit more of a more time to interpret. Movie has to be through Amazon Prime at $2.99. I would never advise a group of people to watch it together in some way, should it be illegal to do so. I would never advise that. You can find the 1967 on YouTube for free. That's what I like to hear. can't we do a WP? WP means what? It's okay, no worries. Also, let's just say Anyone new to the group, I hope you enjoyed. We are about to be finished. If anyone returning, thank you for coming. Anyone that spoke, enjoy, and shared with us, any watch party, thank you all. Anyone that shared with us, thank you so much for your diligence and your research. Anyone that researched and didn't share with us, that's okay. I hope it illuminated different parts of the book. I hope you continue to do research like this whenever we are taking in a new piece of artwork or whatnot. Often finding out what goes into it is some of the most fascinating parts. So thank you. We have a couple minutes. Do you guys want to see a painting I bought? I'm very excited about it. It's from that like abstract expressionist time. I was kind of motivated. But yeah, I'm gonna show you guys because I'm really proud. Right? Isn't it cool? I'm pretty excited about it. Yeah. Okay. One more time. Isn't that cool? I'm trying to not get any glare. All right. Okay, so part three for Saturday, I will share again what time. If you want to watch the 1967 version by part... Oh! Should we do that? Should we watch the 1967... You know what? I'm going to put a couple polls this week. So be prepared. The artist is Raymond Parker. Pretty cool. It's awesome. Thanks, guys. We're about to be finished indeed. So, Lexi, yes, please tweet the links. I will share. I will also share the 1967 movie and a couple of polls to talk about that. Part three from now on. I'm thinking we might watch the 1967 version for next week, even though we're not done with the book yet. That hasn't bothered me, right? So I'll put the polls up so we can all check it out and see what's up. And yeah, thank you so much for today. Turned my entire day around. I really appreciate it. Anyone that's new and watching that hasn't commented or whatever, we really appreciate you being here. Thank you so much. I hope you know that you don't have to comment. Just watching and taking part and reading is just enough. Everyone that does comment and contribute, thank you so much. I bet often people that don't are happy that you do, even if it makes you nervous, so thank you. I will see you all next Saturday with part three for sure. Everything else we'll put in the polls. Yes, have a wonderful day. And remember, continue to learn, continue to grow, continue to question things, continue to push yourselves, and continue to be positive forces of change in your communities. Even today, you already were a positive force of change in mine. So thank you all. I will see you next week.